Welcome to Northwest Unitarian Universalist Church. It is good to be gathered, even virtually. Our minister, the Reverend Kevin DeBeck, is our speaker this morning. I am Diana Kohler, and I'm the worship associate. Our staff members, Ben Gable, Ken Hermanon, Eva Leventer, and Alex Myers, all have helped create and present our worship service today. We are grateful for them. We extend a special welcome to any visitors here this morning, and I know there may be members of the UU Fellowship of Elkhart, Indiana with us, and special welcome to you. If you're a visitor and you would like us to stay in touch with us, you can fill out the visitor form you see in the chat box. The chat feature has been disabled except for chatting directly with the tech host. If you're having problems with Zoom, and who doesn't occasionally, use the chat function or the raise hand function in Zoom, and the tech host will chat with you. And it wouldn't be Northwest without announcements. So we have very specific indoor gathering guidelines. These are available on our website. And they're predicated by the risk levels in our community. Our youth religious education program is currently taking place outside, and the youth are doing all kinds of fun things. If you have a child who needs to be registered for the religious education program, please do so. You can contact Eva and her information is probably also available on the website. You could go to an orchard next Sunday in Northville with youth programs, regardless of how old you are. It will offer apple picking, donuts, ciders, and more. And they suggest that you bring a chair or a blanket in addition to your mask. On Sunday the 24th at noon after the church, there's going to be a nature walk at the community nature at the Southfield Carpenter Lake Nature Preserve. Our service auction is coming up, so it's almost time to donate. So we need to be thinking about that. And our auction website will be available to check out starting Sunday, September 26th, which is today. Events held at the church are not subject to rental fees, but if you're holding an event there, there is an extra cleaning fee. And we have to follow the UU gathering guidelines at the time the events are held. COVID continues to control a lot. We have a small group training coming up this Wednesday from 6:30 to 8 o'clock, offered by the Leadership Development Team. You can contact Jan Berger-Cohen if you're interested in participating. We have a job fair coming up Sunday, October 10th after church. We have a small group spirit week with breakout rooms Monday through Wednesday on October 11th through the 13th. You can join a small group there or create one. Again, contact Jan. There is a fall retreat for women taking place Friday through Sunday, November 5th through 7th at the River Hawk Lodge in Proud Lake State Recreation Area. There are 12 rooms with two beds in each room. So if you're interested, talk to Amanda Spurrell. Board meeting for the Board of Governors is October 14th. It will be followed by our congregational meeting on the 17th. Your feedback on the eighth principle will help the Board of Governors select a working group to put the eighth principle into action in our congregation. If you haven't yet signed the quilt for Kimmy, contact Mark Badcock. Our plate collection this month is going to the Southfield Emergency Needs Fund. 6 months out of the year, we support short-term services for Southfield residents experiencing hardship. You can text your amount, or you can send a contribution into the church.
Good morning, everybody. I am the Reverend Kevin DeBeck. My pronouns are he, him, and his. And my opening words this morning are by the Reverend Kathy Huff. And she says, Spirit of life, be present with us at this hour. Join us today as we gather in a wider search for truth and purpose. In this quest, may we greet one another with open hearts and minds. May we inspire each other to consider new questions and seek deeper meaning. And may we cultivate wisdom and compassion. Let all who enter this sanctuary, albeit virtual, see a welcome face, hear a kind word, and find comfort in this community. And may all that is done and said here today be in service to love and justice.
Our first reading is A Spark of Hope by Dr. Melanie Davis. And you can see that I lit candles for the joys and sorrows that we heard this morning. If ever there were a time for a candle in the darkness, this would be it. Using a spark of hope, kindle the flame of love, ignite the light of peace, and feed the flame of justice. Our first hymn this morning is Just As Long As I Have Breath.
Is among you, recrafted with permission of the author Francis Dorff O'Priam of the Norbertine community of Albuquerque, New Mexico, from his story, The Rabbi's Gift, which is copyrighted by the New Catholic Magazine. Mr. Cohen was the teacher of the most quarrelsome class, third grade class. The kids in the class argued about everything. They argued about who should stand in front of the line. They argued about what games to play at recess. They argued about who was the best reader in class. And if Mr. Cohen asked them whether it was a sunny or rainy day outside, they even argued about that. Mr. Cohen was at his wit's end. There was so much arguing going on that no one was learning anything. When they tried to do multiplication problems, Janie and Stan argued about whether 2 times 2 was the same as 2 plus 2. Or not. When it was the time for the spelling, Carmen and Ling began to quibble about who would get the first turn in the spelling bee. In music class, Carlos and Beth each tried to grab the tambourine, and Carlos ended up in the nurse's office with the tambourine hit him on the head. Mr. Cohen tried everything. He promised the class an ice cream party if they could get through just one day without an argument. No sooner had he made his offer when Carlos and Bobby began to argue about whether they should have chocolate ice cream or a cookie dough. Mr. Cohen threatened the class. He told them he would send anyone to the principal's office for arguing. That didn't work either. The principal, Mr. Sanchez, pulled Mr. Cohen aside at lunchtime and politely but firmly said, "I've had 15 students in my class this morning." She hoped to be able to get back to work for that afternoon. Mr. Cohen called the parents. He tried very politely, asking the kids to stop. He kept the class in at recess, but nothing worked. There was only one thing left to do. Mr. Cohen went to his synagogue on the Sabbath and prayed. His rabbi told him, as he was at his despair, the rabbi listened to Mr. Cohen's tale of the most difficult argumentative third grade class in history. And when she had heard it all, she simply said, "Stay home from work on Monday and leave it to me." That Monday, the kids walked into their classroom and found the rabbi sitting at Mr. Cohen's desk. Of course, they immediately began to argue about whether Mr. Cohen was sick or whether Mrs. Sanchez had finally gotten tired of him and decided to fire him. The rabbi sat and listened. She didn't yell or try to interrupt them. She didn't plead or scold. She simply sat quietly at Mr. Cohen's desk. After a while, the kids began to wonder what was going on. The arguing gradually died down as the kids watched the rabbi to see what would happen next. When the classroom was finally quiet, the rabbi slowed down, stood up. "Mr. Cohen will not be in today. I am your substitute teacher, but I have only one thing to teach you. Listen carefully for now, for I will not repeat." The kids were too surprised to argue. The rabbi's voice rang in the stunned silence. "Last night in my dreams, God told me a Messiah is among you." They argued, of course, a pandemonium broke out in the classroom as the kids argued about who might be the Messiah. It couldn't be Charles. He was always getting into mischief. But on the other hand, Charles could also always be counted on to help a friend or share his lunch. And Ling was clearly too bossy to be the Messiah. But then again, Ling went to church every Sunday and prayed every night before bed. What about Janie? She always did her work so carefully and neatly. The arguing didn't stop. Mr. Cohen returned to school on Tuesday morning, and the first thing he heard was Stan's angry voice. "I'm telling you, Carmen, Bobby is the Messiah. Just the other day, I saw him comforting a first grader who had scraped her knee." Isn't that the sort of thing a Messiah would do? Soon, however, the arguing began to disappear. When Janie began to argue with Charles that she would be the line leader, she suddenly offered the stand behind him in line. After all, Charles might be the Messiah. And in music class, Carlos and Beth took turns using the tambourine. After all, one of them might be the Messiah. All that year, kids kept trying to figure out who might be the Messiah. They began to think about each other differently. They noticed all the good things about each other. Stan was a good artist and huge imagination. Ling was passionate and strong. Carmen was the most loyal friend you could ask for. And Mr. Cohen, he was gentle and kind teacher. Maybe he was the Messiah. The kids began to think of themselves differently. Each child wondered, "Could I be the Messiah?" The children were inspired to try to be their best. Soon, the kids in Mr. Cohen's class had a reputation of treating one another well. The teachers came from far and wide to visit Mr. Cohen's class. The year ended up and the kids in Mr. Cohen's class graduated having learned a very important lesson that they would never forget. Everyone around you is special and anyone could be a Messiah. The next fall, Mr. Cohen looked at his brand new class of third graders. Already, John and Anna were arguing about whether or not alligators were the same as crocodiles. "Good morning, children," he said. "Has anyone ever heard of the Messiah?" He lowered his voice to a whisper. And so everyone had to be quiet and listen. And he said, "I have been told there is a Messiah in this class."
This reading comes from a report of the American Academy of Pediatrics, Transgender and Adolescent Suicide Behavior was published in September 2018. Nearly 14% of all adolescents reported a previous suicide attempt. Dramatic disparities by gender identity and suicide attempts were found. Female to male adolescents reported the highest level of attempted suicide, 50.8%, followed by adolescents who identified as not exclusively male or female, 41.8%. Male to female adolescents reported 29.9% of previous suicide attempts. Questioning adolescents reported 27.9% having previously attempted suicide. Among all female adolescents, the rate was 17.6%, and all male adolescents, it was 9.8%. Identifying as non-heterosexual exacerbated the risk for all adolescents, except for those who did not exclusively identify as male or male, i.e. non-binary. For transgender adolescents, no other socio-demographic characteristic was associated with suicide attempts. Our next hymn is "Sleep, My Child."
Sleep, my child, and peace attend you all through the night. I who love you shall be near you all through the night. Suffer drowsy hearts or creeping, give and fail his slumber sleeping. I, my loving vigil keeping all through the night. Mother, I can feel you near me all through the night. Father, I know you can hear me all through the night. Visions of
This month's Soul Matters theme is cultivating relationship, and it's of relationships to others and those that are close to us that I wish to discuss with you all today. I am aware of how toxic the water of supremacy has been, and I have a vision of where it gets easier for me and for all of us to notice it, all the while not losing my ability to step up and call myself and others on it. My vision is for the day when we are all aware of living with the bees that are swarming around us and how not to get stung and help others. Of course, in my scenario, we don't hurt the bees, but we smash the patriarchy instead. My other vision is that for the great and glorious day when, maybe because patriarchy is smashed, every person in the US is really equal and can reach out to help others who, other cultures who oppress each other. While race is always an issue for my preaching because supremacy oppresses people of color everywhere, today I wish to share a different slice of my vision for equality, and it has quite personal roots. My vision for queer kids is that they live long and prosper. You kind of see what I did there. They all know that they are enough, that they love themselves, that they know that they are enough, that they love themselves and their world. I am a parent, as many of you know. My son is 21 and is giving college another shot after a couple of false starts and is thinking of becoming a special education teacher. My youngest, as I mentioned earlier, who just turned 18, is finishing her senior year at Elkhart High School here in Indiana. She's not sure where she will go to school after high school yet, but she has visions of going to film school and working on horror movies for a living. How about that? She is surrounded by friends and family who affirm who she is and what her potential could be. Her vision for her own future is filled with possibilities. And yet it wasn't always this way. And before I dive further, I just want you all to know that she has given me permission to share her story with you all today. In January of 2018, I was getting ready to go to Meadville for my final set of classes. My wife informed me that our youngest child was struggling with suicidal depression and has come out and came out as being transgender. She had been born biologically male and her body didn't match who she felt who she really was. On the day of her birth, we at that point named him at that time Charlie. And for the first 14 years of her life, we treated her as if she were male. But in 2018, she had reached a crisis point. And even though my UU minister wife has been an LGBTQ advocate for over 30 years, and I've been a UU for over 20 years, Eliza didn't trust us where she could tell us her truth until she had reached a crisis point, until she literally couldn't live with herself anymore. After my classes were done, my wife and I had multiple conversations as we wrapped our heads around what was really happening. And we knew the statistics. Much of what you heard in the reading today was going through our minds. Another stat that is commonly discussed in trans circles that the life expectancy of trans women of color is 35. Think about that, 35 years old. And so while these thoughts were swirling around, close friends of ours in another state had a trans child who had committed suicide the year before. The overriding feeling we had about our situation is that we needed to get on board if we wanted to save our child's life. My wife and I also realized that we had to mourn the loss of the child who was and celebrate the child who was becoming. Now, do you all recall the story of the Velveteen Rabbit? In the beginning of the story, the rabbit asks the very old toy, the skin horse, how you know when you become real. His answer is, it doesn't happen all at once. You become. It takes a long time. That's why it doesn't happen often to people who break easily or have sharp edges or who have to be carefully kept. My daughter was in the process of becoming. Her coming out made me look in the mirror and face some ugly truths about myself as well. I consider myself a feminist, and yet faced with the truth of my son becoming my daughter I was confronted with the feeling of, why would you do that? Being a white guy is an easier way to get through life. Why give that up? It was also a point of pride in my part to say that I had two sons, as if helping to give birth to boys somehow raised my status as being male. And this speaks to the insidiousness of white supremacy. White supremacy informs us that if you hit the genetic jackpot and are born white, male, and cisgender, you're on top of the cultural food chain. White supremacy is like any kind of addiction. It gets in the way of all of us being fully human. White supremacy allows for the justification to lock children in cages, the denial of voting rights, the denial of healthcare, the warming of the only planet we've ever called home, and allowing sexual predators to go unpunished, and so on, and so on, and so on. In addition to the statistics that was in our reading for today, there are others that are as equally grim. According to the Trans Students Educational Resources, an organization that is entirely run by trans youth, 1 in 5 trans people have experienced homelessness in their lives, 1 in 8 have been evicted for being trans, and trans people of color are 6 times more likely to experience violence at the hands of the police than their white counterparts. I also want to add that the state of my permanent address here in Indiana, in the last few years, passed a hate crimes law, and I use air quotes because it is so toothless, it doesn't actually cover anything. And in the process of drafting this law, they did not add sexual orientation or gender expression into the civil rights laws. So here in Indiana, it's still legal to be fired from your job or to lose your living space if you are gay or trans. All of this begs the question, what are we going to do about it? Changing laws takes time and energy, and if one has a trans kid in the household, changing laws is on the low end of the list. Now, according to the Human Rights Campaign website, the best way for a trans teen to survive adolescence is support from the family of origin, and this is words from their website. Familial support can act as a buffer against bullying and bias outside the home. As child welfare expert Caitlin Ryan has demonstrated, family acceptance predicts greater self-esteem, social support, and general health status for LGBTQ youth. It also protects against depression, substance abuse, and suicidal ideation and behaviors. And that's the end of those words. When you, this congregation, or any other organization stands up for trans youth and adults, not only are you helping to save a life, you're also pushing back against the dominant cultural paradigm of white supremacy. Our first principle states that we believe in the inherent worth and dignity of every person, and here's the way we live into that covenant. I'm also reminded of the first General Assembly I ever went to, and this was in Salt Lake City way back in 1999, which doesn't really feel like it was that long ago, when during the opening ceremony, a minister stood up in the pulpit and addressed the people who were in the convention hall and loudly said, "This religion saves lives." And I believe that, and I believe that to be true. Our congregation supports these groups, and our principles help us to understand that everyone has inherent worth and dignity. But what can be done away from these hallowed halls or walls or a virtual reality during the week? Well, the Human Rights Campaign has a website, or on their website, they have suggestions for that as well. Under the banner of Simple Ways to Support Your Transgender Child, they offer these suggestions. Always use the child's preferred gender pronouns and preferred names. I would add, if you don't know, ask. Be your child's advocate. Call out transphobia when you see it and ask that others respect your child's identity. Educate yourself about the concerns facing transgender youth and adults. Encourage your child to stand up for themselves when it is safe to do so. And the most important part, assure your child that they have your unconditional love and support. I'm able to report today that my daughter lives her life as Eliza and educates people everywhere she goes with patience and confidence, and at the same time doesn't put up with any guff if someone gives it to her or gives her or any of her friends a hard time. This past July, we went through the Indiana court system and officially changed her name and gender marker. And we are currently working on moving her name change to the government. So that way, when she does eventually get her driver's license, which might be sooner than later, it will be all of the information on there will be accurate. We are also lucky that she has the support of the administration and the teachers of the high school she goes to, which is kind of shocking considering where we live. It was a really big surprise to my wife and I. My vision for a brighter future of equality looks good in her hands with her peers and her cohort group who get that the toxic supremacy water does not have to infect everything forever. She is teaching me that I don't have to be beholden to a culture I didn't ask for and don't want. She also taught me that even when I look myself in the mirror and don't like what I see, there's a way to overcome it. She is also reminding me of one of the reasons why I was called to seminary, to push back against white supremacy and help others to see that they don't need to participate in that culture either. My daughter has also reinforced for me the power of unconditional love, a love so powerful it can literally save a life. Reflecting back on the Velveteen Rabbit, it was the boy's love of the rabbit that made him feel real. In the case of my daughter, it was the love that she had for herself that made her real. May the rest of us take that light and share it with the rest of the world. Our closing hymn today is hymn number 116, I'm On My Way. Say our closing words today. I've been asked that everybody online, once I'm done with the closing words, Lois mentioned today was her birthday, and I know it's hard to sing over Zoom, but I think we should try to all sing Lois a happy birthday. So hang on one second. Our closing words today is from Jean Olson, and she says, May you be brave enough to expose your aching woundedness and reveal your vulnerability. May you speak your deepest truths, knowing that they will change as you do. May you sing the music within you, composing your own melody, playing your song with all your heart. May you draw, sculpt, paint, and sew, showing the world your vision. May you write letters, poetry, biography, slogans, graffiti, the great novel, laying bare your words to love and hate. May you love even though your heart breaks again and again, and until the end of your days, may your life be filled with possibilities and courage. May it be so. All right, so let's try to sing this all together.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday.